Yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks for having me. Thanks for the kind introduction. Yeah, as said, I will tell you a bit about the role of free software during the corona crisis and also give you an outlook on what happens next. That was quick. So for those of you who don't know us, the Free Software Foundation Europe, so we are a charity empowering users to control technology. And among these users are us, but also governments, public bodies. And this is what this talk is about and also what the Public Money, Public Code campaign is about. Roughly 1.5 years ago in March last year, borders have been closed. I think you all remember this. And Europe relies heavily on the principle of free movement, free borders, and traveling. So while borders have been closed to Corona, we had the situation that we needed to somehow open these borders up again, and software has been involved, which I'm going to show you later, and in particular, free software has been used. Also, all of us have been working in home office. We are still working in home office, doing remote events, hybrid events like here, and also here, we heavily relied on free software. And this is also what I'm going to show you in the next 10 and 15 minutes. So the universe needed free software, and free software helped during that time to tackle the crisis, and also will help us to tackle future crises. But first of all, what is free software? Free software gives you four freedoms. You can use, study, share, and improve. So, and whenever you have these four freedoms, then we call it free software. Sometimes it's also called open software, libre software, or so on. But whenever we have these four freedoms to use, study, share, and improve, then we call it free software. And this means you can use the software for any purpose without any restrictions. You can study the code, it's transparent, so anyone can analyze the code, can see what the software does. Also, you are free to share the software, again, without any limitations, and also the price doesn't matter. So free is not like free in beer, but you can also earn money with free software. And the fourth freedom is to improve or to modify the software. So everybody can not only see the code, but also contribute to the code, and by thus give back to the community. And this also doesn't mean necessarily that you need to be a coder to contribute. This is also something we will see in the next minutes. But also others can contribute to software, and this is also very important. To make it clear, I have a slide to show you the advantages of free software and the problems coming with proprietary software. First of all, with proprietary software, you don't have any interoperability, and this is a huge issue. So systems don't work together, you are not connected, so there is no interoperability, you're so in a very closed system, and this is also coming with a vendor lock-in. So whenever you buy proprietary software, you're stuck in a vendor lock-in, and you always need to go back to this one vendor to get APIs, to get updates, upgrades, and so on. And this is a huge problem, especially when you want to work together across borders. This also comes with unpredictable costs for maintenance. As said, you have to pay for updates and upgrades, and you never know in the beginning what you have to pay at one day, and thus you never know how much you have to pay in the future. And this also means your investments are lost because you have to pay for licenses as well. So whenever you buy proprietary software, you buy a license to get this, and when you want to work on another workstation, you have to buy for another license. So this is not the case if you use free software. And also what we've seen during the corona crisis, just remember, for example, tracing apps, there's a low acceptance by citizens as the code is not transparent and you can't see if, for example, fundamental rights are protected. So this is also something we have seen during the crisis, that free software, open, transparent code gives you acceptance by citizens. And you also have security issues as you can't look into the code, and thus it makes you gives you a hard time to find backdoors, for example, or other security issues. So the solution to all of these issues is free software, coming with the four freedoms. As you have open standards, you always have interoperability by default. so which is key if you want to work across borders, across languages. And also, you're very independent through free licenses, so you don't have to pay for a license. You just get it, and you are independent. You have these four freedoms. You can modify, for example, and so on. And by that, you can also collaborate and share risks and costs. You can collaborate across borders, which is, again, key also for global crisis. And also, you can, on the other hand, involve local partners. So whenever you buy proprietary software, you go just to a vendor, then you get the piece of software, and that's it. And mainly, they are based in the US or in China or somewhere else. With free software, you can involve local partners. And we see whenever public bodies or governments procuring free software, then this is mainly done with local partners, which is also good for your local economy. And as said, we have this transparent code, so it's transparent by default, which gives you a lot of acceptance by citizens. And you can see, for example, if fundamental rights are protected, as you can see in the code, what's happening there. And this transparency also gives you the chance to search for security risks, so you can see what the code does and find backdoors, for example. And so what happened during the crisis? So we had this global problem, and on the same side, we need a global solution to tackle this, and software played an important role during the crisis. So these global problems come with mainly similar demands everywhere in the world. So they're slightly different, but it's more or less everywhere in the world the same demand. And this came with specific hardware and specific software we needed during the time. Just remember home office, but also these tracing and now the certificate apps. So this is something we heavily used in the last 1.5 years, these apps, but also for home office video conferencing, what we are using here now. I think you use Jitsi, as far as I see, for your hybrid talks. So this is also based on free software. So we heavily need software to stay connected to tackle this crisis. And the global solution, again, here is to use systems with open standards so that we can work together where we have interoperability, where we can work across borders without any issues. And we need these free licenses with the four freedoms to use, study, share, and improve the code. And by thus, we can collaborate and foster innovation, because there is no sense that every country makes its own solution, but we need one solution, mainly fitting it all. Maybe we need to do translations, sure, but in the end, it's mainly always the same solutions. And also, we have seen during the debate, especially on the tracing apps, that transparency is key. So acceptance by citizens, they wanted to know what happens with their data. So it's health data we are processing, and thus we want to have transparent code and see if fundamental rights are respected. And also, this is key, we can involve all stakeholders. This means creating an app is not about only talking to coders and do coding thingies and have an app in the end, but we have seen that we need scientists from every area to tackle this crisis. And thus, they can also contribute to this app, so all stakeholders can be involved in such a process of developing free software, in this regard, mainly apps to tackle the crisis. And on the apps, I want to give you some concrete examples of what happened. So in the very beginning, this was also around March in the last year, we had this debate about the apps, should they be centralized, decentralized, open source, not, and stuff like this. And so we, very early, when we've seen that there's a debate and that there might be the solution going in the direction of app, we released three demands on these apps. So first demand is all of these apps need to be used voluntarily. This is very important. The second one is that they must respect fundamental rights. And to prove that they respect fundamental rights, we need this transparent code. And the third one is they shall be free software. So, and our demands were heard. That was very interesting. So, for example, the World Health Organization released a paper in May 2020, just like 1 month after our press release on this. And after our lobby attempts on this. And they said, it's a very good idea, and all apps need to be full transparency, and the publication must be open source and open access of code. So the World Health Organization understood quickly that the global crisis can only be tackled with open source or in free software. Also, the European Union followed us. There's the eHealth network. The eHealth network is the European Commission and the member states of the European Union. And they also released, back in April 2020, a toolbox for member states, what they shall do in order to release software to tackle this crisis. And here again, they recommended that openly published and technical specification and the source code of the apps as a way to maximize, and this is important, reuse, interoperability, auditability, and security. So they completely followed our arguments, and I think it's very important that they not just said, yeah, it should be somehow open source because it's good, but for example, that they used the argument on security. So we had the first time very strong papers coming from the World Health Organization, but also from European entities saying we need open source because of, and then these arguments came, which is very important. And then we have seen the development of the tracing apps, for example, so you can see the code. It was developed openly. I mean, still there has been some issues. For example, it was not available on FDroid, a free software app store, and so volunteers use the code and make it available to everyone so that you don't need to have an Android phone, for example, but you can also use it with another free software operating system on your phone. But this was mainly doable because, first of all, we had free software here in place. Also, for the CovPass app, to get your certificates, some countries released them completely as free software. For example, in Switzerland, it was directly available on FDroid. In Germany, again, we had to fix it with the help of volunteers to make it available on FDroid. But this is mainly done because we have the chance with free software to modify and to make it available to everyone. And so this is key in the crisis to have free software. But what happened later, after we had all of these apps and all of the commitments, was in October 2020, the European Commission gave itself an open source strategy for the next 3 years called Think Open. And we awaited this strategy for a long time. And then we were a bit disappointed because it happened half a year after this strong commitment by the Commission to say, yeah, it must be open source because of security reasons and so on. But then, with this paper, they said, we want to have open source whenever it makes sense, so without explaining when it is like this. And also, they introduced a loophole to allow them to choose non-open technologies where there are good reasons to do so. And this also remains open when such a situation arrives. So we see the strong commitment directly after the crisis was watered down in the next months. And then it happened that we got such a paper. Still, I mean, we have this open source strategy and we now have something for the European Commission where we can say, please follow this somehow. But at the same time, it's coming with a lot of loopholes. And also they want to set up a small program office to make sure that open source comes into the European Commission. So it's not a very strong paper they released. And so that's why we already before the crisis started a campaign called Public Money, Public Code. And with this campaign, we demand that publicly financed software must be made publicly available under a free software license because it helps us all, not only administrations, but also citizens. And there are very good reasons to have free software. So first of all, it's about digital sovereignty. So you should be in control over the systems you use, especially as a government, as a public body, as an administration. And also, they are financed by taxes, so our money. And so if we pay for the software, it should be also available to us. And so that's why we released this campaign. And just a reminder, 25%, up to 27% of the revenue of software firms is generated by public bodies. So just imagine if we use this money to invest in software we need for home office, for example, because administrations are also in home office, we would have way better solutions than we see today. And so therefore, we have this campaign, Public Money, Public Code, already before the crisis, and it's going to be even more important after the crisis. So if you haven't supported, you can sign this campaign and support us with this campaign, and we are going to continue to lobby for free software in Europe. Thanks a lot.